Good morning, students. Welcome back to this software engineering class again. Today we are going to discuss about software engineering approach for developing a software. In the last class, we discussed about some of the challenges with the software engineering, like you have the scale is as a scale as a challenge, quality and productivity as a challenge, then consistency and repeatability as a challenge, and change as a challenge. Now we are going to discuss about software engineering approach. Okay. In software engineering, we concentrate mainly on processes. What is this process? So the definition of the software engineering says that software engineering is a systematic approach for developing a software, maintenance of a software, operation of a software, and the retirement of a software. So what is the systematic approach? The methodology of developing a software. That I call it as a process. A process is a systematic approach of developing a process or software. So using a process, you should be able to develop a software, maintain a software, retiring a software, update a software, everything. Okay, so what is your process you are using to develop a software? Okay, the process can be categorized into two categories, namely development process and managing the process. Okay, what are the various methods that are used to develop a software? See, most of the software companies use a phased development process. Phased development process for developing a software. Then how that development is maintained, managed? Okay, for that we need a process that is called managing the process. So process is for developing and managing the process. First, we see the development process. In the development process, we will concentrate mainly on the phased development process, and that is the kind of development process that is used very effectively in most of the software development companies and problems. Okay. The name itself should tell you something. Your developer is given a problem to automate, that is to develop a software. The developer will not try to tackle the problem as a whole. If he does that, he will miserably fail. So what he does is he divides the problem into various phases. Each phase produces output that might become an input for the next phase. So in a phased development process, the problem is divided into various phases, and each phase is ending with a defined output. Okay, what are the advantages of dividing the problem into various phases, software development work into various phases? The advantages are many. One thing is, the problem is not tackled as a whole. By that, you will end up with some problems. That is, the solution is not attempted as a whole. Okay, by dividing the work into various phases, the cost of development is reduced. Okay, how it is reduced? The reduction of the cost is might be due to several issues that you use in phase development process. Okay, by reducing the error that you commit in coding. Okay, mostly what happens is the cost of writing a code is less comparing to identifying the errors in the code and maintaining the code, okay, understanding the code. Okay, so the phased development process will reduce the cost, and also at each stage, at your required or at your will, you can check the quality. The developer can check the quality of the progress. Okay, whether in this phase, whether the particular level of quality is maintained or not, that can be checked. At any stage, the quality can be checked out in the phased development process. That is our advantage. So the cost is reduced, quality can be checked at any stage. Okay, there are several phased development methods that can be attempted, like waterfall model or spiral model, iterative model, time boxing model. Various models are there, development process models are there. Whatever be the development process models used, all these models have at least four sets of development, four steps of development, namely analyzing the problem, designing the problem, coding the problem, testing the problem. Just testing, analyzing, requirement analysis, design, coding, testing. These are all the four activities that are employed in whatever the development process models are that are used. Now, what is this requirement specification or requirement analysis? This is nothing but understanding the problem that is given, understanding and clearly stating, or not only understanding and expressing what is the problem is. That is called a requirement specification. That is the very first stage in any software development. So that should be given proper importance, because an error that is committed in requirement analysis stage and hence requirement specification stage, it is very difficult to rectify that error in the subsequent stages like designing and coding. Okay, that error will be picked up only when the software is executed. So the requirement specific requirement analysis stage should be given due importance during the development process. So the developer or problem analyst should understand clearly what is the problem. Okay, and he should specify the problem in its requirement specification document. Then the next set of activity is designing deciding a plan for the solution, deciding a plan for the solution, that is called a design stage. Okay, how you are going to approach, that is. Then the next stage, next activity is coding, where planned solution is implemented in the programming language the developer uses. Okay, then the next set of next activity is testing, verifying what the code is given for its correctness and other things. So in a phased development process, four activities are done, that is problem analysis, design, coding and testing. Coding and testing. Okay. Now let us give some importance about this requirement analysis. Why we perform this requirement analysis? The requirement analysis is performed to understand the problem the software system is supposed to solve. What is the problem? What the software should do for this problem? For that, we perform the requirement analysis. Usually, it is done by a analyst, requirement analyst. Here we try to identify what is needed from the system. Okay, what the software should do. That is the goal. It is not how the system should do. That is not the goal of this requirement analysis. What the software should do. That is the goal of this requirement analysis. Once the idea about what the system should do is derived, then the idea should be documented in a document called software requirement specification document. Okay, so the need for software requirement specification document is, by going through the software requirement specification document, both the client, that is the customer, and the developer can understand very clearly whether the developer understood the problem clearly and also whether the client has expressed his problem very clearly. So in a way, the software requirements or specification document function as a contract between the developer and the customer. Okay, so what is the problem? And that should be understood, that should be expressed in a document. What is the problem is in the mind of the problem analyst. Okay, whatever he has captured about the problem, that he should express it in a specification language. The specification language might be in the form of diagrams, or pseudocodes, or symbols, or anything. Okay, so the next stage of problem analysis is specifying the understood problem in a language. Okay. The other characteristics of this requirement specification document is, it should tell what are the functional and performance requirements. Okay, the customer comes with different needs. The requirement specification document should tell various, all the functional operations that are required by the customer. Okay, And also the requirement specification document should tell about the input formats and the output formats. Okay. And also it should express about the design constraints like environmental constraints and political constraints, cost constraints, security constraints, various constraints that should explain. So when the requirement specification document is scrutinized by anyone, they should be able to understand for which problem this SRS document is given, what are the problems involved in it, and they should get a clear idea of what the problem, what the software should do. Okay, requirement analysis. Then second set of activity is software design. At the end of the problem analysis, the developer knows what is the problem. Now the purpose of the design phase is to plan a solution for the problem that is understood in the problem analysis stage. Okay, so the problem is available in the requirement document. Now in the design stage, a plan for the solution is attempted. Okay, so we are moving from the state of what is needed into the state of how to achieve the solution. Okay, how to satisfy the needs of the customer. Okay, from the question of what, the developer is moving into how. Okay, so this design activity produces three outputs, namely architecture design, high level design, and detailed design. There are three outputs of this design activity. What is this architecture design? The architecture design will divide the software solution into various components, and how the components interact with each other and how they produce the desired result. That is the role of your architecture design. Okay, what are the various components here? Okay, then the high level design is identifying various modules. Okay, for this problem, this is the module that is required. This is the next module that is required, like that. For example, in finding if the problem is to add two polynomials, addition of two polynomials. Okay, some various modules are, there should be a module for reading the polynomial. There should be a module for displaying the polynomial. There should be a module for adding two polynomials. There are at least three modules are needed. Okay, so like that, this high level design identifies various modules that are needed to develop the solution, and what are the characteristics, what should these modules should do. Everything is highlighted in the high level design. Okay, then comes the detailed design. This tells about the logical aspect of each module. Okay, for example, how to read a polynomial, how to read a polynomial, then how to add two polynomials. These things are available in the detailed design. So the software design involves planning a solution. The developer move from what to how. Three kinds of outputs are there: architecture design, high level design, and detailed design. Okay. The next stage of activity is coding. what is this coding? At the end of the architecture or data design, you have a solution for the plan. Okay. You have a plan for the solution. Okay. The coding is going for the writing necessary executable statements for the plan that is given in the design stage. So the goal of the coding phase is to translate the design of the system into a code. Okay, the developer may choose the correct programming languages for coding. Okay, that might be that is decided based on the environment available in the customer side, or depending on the nature of the problem being given. There are various issues are there in deciding a programming language to code the given solution plan given by the design. Okay, coding is very important. Why? It was in the very beginning I told you that a good coding will reduce the error. Developing a code is less costlier than testing the code and maintaining the code. Okay, so a good code will reduce the testing of the code and the maintenance of the code, and hence reduce the cost of the code. So the focus on coding is to write a code that is logically correct, easy to understand, and easy to read. Easy to read means easy to understand. The logical aspect of the coding should be easy to understand. Okay, it is not about coding that is easy to write. Okay, so coding plays an important role in reducing the cost. The next set of activity is testing. Okay. Testing not only starts with the coding stage, it starts from the very beginning stage. Testing is done at the end of the first phase, namely the problem analysis phase. So by testing whether the analyst understood the problem clearly, test whether the customer explained his problem very clearly, test whether both the parties mutually agrees about the problem specification document. These things are done in the problem analysis testing. Then testing is performed on the design, whether the right modules are used, whether all the necessary modules are incorporated, they are all specified, whether all components are used, that testing is done there. Then testing of the code, coding, whether the coding is correct, whether whatever the plans specified in the design is implemented in the coding or not, whether the coding is effective, syntactically correct, logically correct, everything is done here. Okay. It is essential, if we fail to do that and if we don't pick up any error, the damage is very costly. Okay. Various testing that are done are unit testing, integration testing, system testing, and acceptance testing. What is this unit testing? Say in the design phase, we introduce various modules and components. Okay, so the unit test will test those modules that are given in the design phase, those components that are given in the design phase. Okay. Integration testing. It means the flow between one module to another module. See, mind that it should be understood that modules are interconnected. No module can be completely independent of other modules. Okay, so the integration testing will ensure that whether the modules are interconnected correctly, whether the flow between one module to another module is correct or not, everything is performed in the integration testing. In the system testing, whether all the requirements given by the customer are accomplished or not, whether it has all the functions needed for a system are given or not. Everything should be given in the system testing. Okay, then. Acceptance testing. The last one is acceptance testing. It will check the software on real life data of the client. Okay, whether the software is performing all the expectations of the customer, everything that is given, that is tested in the acceptance testing. Real life data are supplied by the client. Okay, so it is tested, might be in the environment, customer's environment. Okay, so four activities are problem analysis activity, design activity, coding activity, testing activity. These are the activities that are used in any of the phased development, phased development process models. Okay. Whether in the next class we will be discussing about waterfall model, prototype model, there we will see all these stages are used. Okay, so these are the issues about developing process. Then the next one is managing the process. Okay, managing a process requires information upon which the management decisions are made. Okay, to make any decision, the management needs proper information. Okay, then only they can decide about certain things and other things. Okay, for this we use two metrics, namely product metrics and the process metrics. Okay, they are collectively called as software metrics. Software metrics. It is an important area where many good deal of work is going on. The software metrics is used for problem analysis, requirement specification, coding, testing, design. In all these things, the software metrics are used. Okay, what is the software metrics? The software metrics are quantifiable measures. Okay, that could be used to measure different characteristics of a software system or the software development process. Okay, theoretically we plan for many various things, the developer plans for various things, and ultimately he should need a numerical proof that this process is going well, this development is going well, These things are achieved with the software metrics. It is a mathematical way of concluding whether the development process is in the right direction or not. So software metrics are quantifiable measures that could be used to measure different characteristics of a software system or the software development process. So as I told you, now there are two types of metrics, namely product metrics and process metrics. The product metrics are used to quantify the characteristics of the product being developed. Okay, here what is developed? The software is getting developed. So the product metrics will try to quantify the characteristics of the software that is getting developed. The process metrics are used to quantify the characteristics of the process, okay, that is used to develop the software. Okay, what method is used to develop the software? That method has its own characteristics, and the characteristics are quantified by the process metrics. Whereas the product metrics gives the characteristics of the software that is being developed. Okay, so it is a nice area. We will discuss more and more about the software metrics in each of the subsequent discussions about requirement specification, design, and coding and testing. In all these areas, we will discuss. Okay, so when you come for tomorrow's class, I want you to brush up with all these ideas and come prepared well. Okay, we will see in the next class.